Buongiorno, amore mio. You speak Italian at all?
Oh, dude, no. My parents are ashamed of me. I don't speak any Italian.
Did they try to teach you when you were younger?
No, they only did that with one of my siblings, and then they never tried to do that again because it was kind of difficult for them to acclimate. You know, I think it was my oldest sibling only spoke Italian at first, because all my parents would speak to him, and then they realized that it was kind of like a setback culturally, you know, to do that to him. So they never really pushed it on me or anyone else.
Yeah, it's important to fit in when you're a kid.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, I was born in England, and when I came here, I had an English accent and then a big old pumpkin head. So it was just brutal from the get-go. But yeah, kids can be cruel.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, again, I don't think, you know, I don't think it was like our parents are trying to like keep me from learning anything. I just think they wanted me to have like, you know, an easy life. They didn't really push it on me too much, but it would have been nice to pick up something. I mean, I learned little phrases and stuff, you know, because there's things my parents would say to each other and to me all the time. But I speak fluent English.
Have you on your touring and traveling, have you gotten a chance to do some tourism in Italy at all? Do you have an interest in that?
Well, yeah, I mean, a little bit. Most of the times we ever performed in Italy was always in northern Italy in this city called Bologna. And unfortunately, when we're in Bologna, there's not really anywhere to go and nothing to see. We would play a club that was next to like a grocery store, and then all that was in the surrounding area, like for miles, which is like farm, but there's nothing else around this nightclub for some reason. But so there wasn't really anywhere to go. But the one time we did go perform in Milan was a treat, because Milan is so beautiful. Like, it's an amazingly aesthetic place to be. So I was really grateful we got to perform there at least once, like, you know, in a real metro kind of place in Italy. But other than that one time, no, unfortunately, a lot of Italy I never got really to experience. So I would have liked to, but.
The new album really kicks butt. You must be stoked.
Yeah, I am stoked that people like it. You know, I think it's a mixed bag. There's people who are not really with the material, and some people who think it's amazing, which I think is not a bad place to be. I mean, I don't know, if your music isn't divisive, then I guess you really didn't make anything worth checking out. So yeah, it's a cool spot to be right now. I mean, the album number 8, and the fact that people are still listening 8 albums deep is a feat in and of itself. So I'm glad people are, you know, checking out the music still.
The new record is called Hindsight, which of course is a great title for those who get it. I would imagine not everybody gets it.
I mean, I don't know. It was more of a marketing decision. It was not my original choice for the name in the album. I mean, the entire album in itself was like something that kind of just grew over time. It was not initially what I set out to create. But then when we were making the album and we were talking to the label and about, you know, how we're going to, like, you know, what we're going to call it and how to promote it and stuff, I personally thought it would be clever to name the record Hindsight, being that it was being released in the year 2020. It also just so happened that the term Hindsight, in and of itself, I think is a good way to describe, like, the lyrical content and themes on the record overall. So it was a mixed bag of just both of things, where I thought on a promotional scale it would really be clever to do, but also, again, I think it really fits the overall theme of the record.
What other titles were considered?
I won't divulge that.
No worries.
In case I want to use them later.
Yeah, of course. Mystery is good.
Yeah.
This is the best album I've heard from this current lineup, which I think there's only been two, right?
Well, there's been a bunch of people in the band over the years. If you go to the Wikipedia page, you'll see a bunch of different colored marks that signify who's been in the band and when. But yeah, this lineup I've had since 2018, with the exception of our bass player Phil, who he was great for the band. I would love to have him in the band, but I can't afford him. He makes great money at home being like the manager of a restaurant or something. So it was hard to get him to kind of, you know, step away from that and do music full time. But yeah, he's a great dude.
Is there a new or different kind of ease to working with the guys now?
I mean, yeah, it's like, you know, being in a band, there's kind of like the regular pitfalls of like dealing with other people, you know, just kind of other people's like egos and emotions and just, you know, personalities. But I mean, I think we all really actually get along quite well for the most part. You know, it's like any relationship. It's like, you know, I say this all the time, familiarity breeds contempt. But you learn to cope, you know, with other people's, you know, quirks and, you know, how they, you know, mesh with you and stuff like that. So I really can't say good things, though, about the change. I mean, you know, being in a band with these guys has been, like, seriously, like, such a breath of fresh air for so many reasons, creatively, personally. So, you know, there's I can't really say anything bad about the, you know, the overall vibe. It's a good time, and I'm glad the shift happened for so many different reasons, but yeah, you know, it's still like, you know, you're in a band, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, someone's gonna one day wake up and fucking be in a mood, or, you know, fucking there's some kind of petty disagreement or creative tension, stuff like that. But it's all, you know, it's just like kind of part of the deal. You know, you can't drink the milk and hate the cow, you know, that's what I'd say.
Yeah, I was recently in a band in Sacramento, and I quit because it wasn't fun anymore, and I realized that there was no real going forward. So I'm still friends with those guys, but it was just time for me to leave, and that's just the way it is sometimes.
Yeah, sure, I guess. So, I mean, I've been in this band for going on 17 years pretty much, but you know, I guess it all depends on what your angle is, you know, whatever it is you want out of it. I just, I don't know, I guess I have a weird stubbornness or whatever about my goals. So I just was like, I don't really care, you know, what happens, you know, in between, as long as I get to my destination. But yeah, you're right. I mean, you know, shit happens. You know, you gotta deal with circumstances as they come.
Is there a concept running throughout the album, or is it more of a collection of songs?
It's definitely a cacophony of feelings and emotions and like vibes and stuff like that. I mean, I don't think any one song on the record sounds like the other. Every single track has some kind of standout thing about it, you know? So there's not any like real like vibe theme. It's just that it's just a representation of where I was at a certain point in my life and where my head was at. But, you know, people really don't realize a lot of times that, and they should, but Amir's music, especially lyrically, is like kind of schizophrenic. So sometimes songs are two subject matters pushed into one, or maybe even sometimes three different subject matters pushed into one. And I just kind of tie them together to make it seem like it's all one cohesive idea. So yeah, I mean, really in short, I don't know. I wouldn't say there's one hardcore tied theme to the record. I don't think I'm able to even really write like that. I'd rather just write authentically to me and put the emotions I think work best for the music. But it definitely represents a place and time for me, and sort of where my head was at, which I could say for every single album.
How did you first get into music? Who or what turned you on to metal or hardcore?
Well, I grew up in a house music, so my whole life I've been listening to, like, you know, my siblings were like the MTV generation. So, like, you know, I had an older brother who was into like Faith No More and Metallica, and my older sister was, you know, she was into Paula Abdul and New Kids on the Block. And my parents were country and doo-wop singers from the 60s. So everything I heard, I liked, you know. And then I got put on to like the underground music scene really young in life. Like, even though I already liked rock music, I liked like Danzig and Bush and stuff like that, and like listening to like alternative radio. It was when like bands like One King Down, Hatebreed, Candiria, One for One. I mean, I can keep going on. You know, I just discovered that stuff. You know, I got put on really young, and then it was around that time where, like, you know, you're, you know, 12, 13 years old, where like you're actually starting to discover music yourself. And then that was when, you know, bands like Korn and Limp Bizkit and Deftones and The Prodigy kind of entered the fold. And, yeah, it just kind of, I don't know, it was just kind of like, you know, it was like lightning struck my brain, you know, and I was like, all right, well, this is what I want to do. Like, this is the coolest thing I could possibly be a part of. So I just never stopped having that feeling, I guess.
It sounds like you've always had sort of an open mind when it comes to your musical taste.
Yeah, you could say that. I mean, I'm a music fan. I don't, genre to me is, secondary as long as I like what I'm hearing, you know.
As you've gotten older, have you matured? And what bad habits are hard to let go?
I mean, I like to think I matured. I don't know what kind of habits you're referring to.
And some people are doing, obviously, the you know, the pandemic has everything shut down. You wouldn't rule out, I mean, Suicide Silence is doing like a empty venue tour. And some people driving are playing at drive-ins. If, you know, you wouldn't rule any of this stuff out, would you?
No, I haven't gotten an invitation yet to do any of these kind of things. I'm open to it. I mean, there's a lot of logistics and a lot that needs to happen to do those things appropriately. So it just has to make sense. You know, the money has to be right. The opportunity has to be right. But I am open to performing, you know, in this kind of new COVID-19 world we're living in. I don't know. I really don't know what's going to happen with that. I mean, we're all just kind of like twiddling our thumbs, hoping that things kind of get better sooner than later, obviously. But, yeah, I mean, every interview I've done almost, I've always said that, yeah, you know, if anyone's hearing this and wants to pay us to play somewhere, as long as, you know, there's proper social distancing, I'm all for it.
What was the first music you bought with your own money, and what would you say is your most prized music collectible?
That's a good question. I have a few things in my collection that I really value. One of them is a vinyl of Limp Bizkit, $3 Billy Y'all. And this, I think the second most valuable thing, or right, there's a few, actually. The other two I would say are, I have a Gigi Allen vinyl, a vinyl pressing of some acoustic songs that he recorded. It's really rare. And I have this Aphex Twin record that I purchased when he performed at this electronic festival in Texas, maybe like 4 years ago now. And it's really rare. I think only like 500 copies exist or something like that. But it's one of the things that I really value. I mean, any physical music that I own is really special to me. But I'm trying to think what the first thing that I got my own money. I think it might have been Prodigy, Fat of the Land, or it might have been Blink-182, Dude Ranch. But I knew I was in middle school at the time, and I had like $20, and that was like, you know, that was what I purchased when I went to the wall, whatever it was called back then. I don't think it was called FYE yet.
Much of your music was released through Victory Records, with the last two being on Sharptone. You're in pretty good company over there.
Yeah. I know the people at Sharptone are, you know, really smart and really know their shit when it comes to monetizing the music. So it's a great spot, you know, for any band to be in. I mean, they really know their stuff, and I'm really grateful that, you know, they're in my corner and have really been a huge supporter of, you know, what we want to accomplish. So it's a good time.
On 203, you sing, "If it be a higher power, I surrender unto thee." Do you want to elaborate a little bit more on that particular song?
I don't really like the idea of explaining songs, mostly because I prefer the listener to have their own unique experience with it. Not that I don't see value in explaining it. I see people are, I understand why people are curious to know, but I think the curiosity is what continues to make the song interesting. So rather than kind of divulge or, you know, just like say what anything is about, I'd rather just people listen to the music and attach their own meaning to it. I think that makes songs way more valuable on a listener perspective, rather than just being like, oh, that's what he means. Okay, cool. Like, just moving on. You know, it removes the fun of discovering and researching. I mean, honestly, as a music fan myself, I personally would rather that. I don't want to really know what the song means or represents. I just want to hear it and make it my own, you know, which I think is the beauty of music, you know?
How cool was it to tour with As I Lay Dying and see their forgiveness in action?
I mean, I've known those guys for a while. Before Tim's legal situation, the last time I was in the room with them, again, prior to that, was we did some shows with them in New Zealand and in Mexico. Some big, big shows. Like, they, you know, they're a huge band. So, it was a phenomenal experience. They've always been really nice dudes. In terms of the whole, like, forgiveness thing, I mean, I'm not really attached to that. I'm not, like, I didn't, like, you know, watch them perform, and it never crossed my mind, like, wow, you know, he's really won these people over. I think that people are fans of the music, you know, like whatever, you know. Yeah, it's just, you know, the guy paid his debt to society. You don't have to agree with or appreciate, you know, any past mistakes or whatever the guy might have made. But again, I don't think the fans were there, you know, with this kind of thing in their head. Like, okay, I forgive you now, so now I like your music again. I think they're just like, they're one of your great tunes, and Azalea Dying is a great band. And I think it just goes to show, just like, that's really the most important part of this whole thing is like the music. I get people try to like say dumbass shit like, you know, oh, I can never support them now, yada yada. It's like, dude, like, if the music fucking is good, I don't give a fuck, honestly, what the person's done. I'm able to separate the person from the music because I want to enjoy the music. You know, I don't really understand people's mindset. It's like, well, they want to eat a cheeseburger, but they don't like the fact that a cow has to die for it. It's like, it's, you know, the world is not a perfect place. You know, it's like just take things at face value, and you know, if it means that you enjoy the music, enjoy the music. Don't stifle your joy because you can't, you know, I don't know, you can't respect or appreciate, you know, what a person might have gone through or done or whatever. I don't know. It's weird to talk about because, again, I don't have an opinion on it. I guess I think the guy pays debt to society, and it's none of my fucking business, truly. But as a fan of the band, I like Azalea Dying. I think they're a great band, and I was stoked to tour with them for that reason alone, just because I think they're awesome, you know, musically.
Well, thanks for taking some time out to talk to us. Do you have any final thoughts you'd like to share with people that might be listening to this?
Yeah, final thoughts would be that, you know, the world is fucked up, and obviously a lot of people seem really divided politically and socially right now, and I think it's garbage. Because the entire reason for human experience is to reduce suffering. And before anyone says or does anything, they should ask themselves if they are reducing the suffering of others. And if they're not, then they should shut the fuck up.